Welcome back to my stand-up channel. Harry lectures GQ Awards about sharing vaccines and claims news and social media misinformation is creating jab hesitancy, hours after Ofcom backs Piers Morgan, who just happened to be in the audience. Prince Harry used a video message from his LA mansion to launch a new assault on the media and lecture on inequality in a surprise speech to VIPs including Piers Morgan hours after the ex-GMB host won a thumping victory for free speech over Meghan Markle. The Duke of Sussex, dressed in a black tie and suit, used his big screen speech beamed to the GQ Awards in London to blame those who peddle in lies and fear in the news media and social media for vaccine hesitancy. He delivered a chiding speech urging governments to do more to vaccinate poorer countries. Warning: until every community can access the vaccine and until every community is connected to trustworthy information about the vaccine, then we are all at risk. Speaking from his Montecito mansion more than 5,000 miles away, the beleaguered prince lectured his star-studded London audience on media misinformation and the importance of sharing vaccines. Harry later presented the Heroes of the Year Award to Professor Dame Sarah Gilbert, Professor Catherine Green and the team behind the Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine. Watching was Piers Morgan, who yesterday won a resounding victory for free speech after regulator Ofcom ruled he had not broken the broadcasting code for his comments on the Duchess of Sussex following her bombshell Oprah interview. Mr. Morgan's ITV colleagues and a string of respected broadcasters hailed Ofcom's ruling confirming his right to free speech after the watchdog dismissed 57,000 complaints about his criticism of Meghan Markle. Senior British journalists have declared that the judgment meant a pillar of our freedom in the UK had been reinforced. Piers was sensationally cleared by Britain's broadcast watchdog who backed his right to free speech after he said that he didn't believe a word of what Meghan Markle told Oprah and challenged her claims of royal racism and suicidal thoughts. The Sussexes did not comment on the judgment, but will have been infuriated by the result given Meghan complained to Ofcom herself and also the Mr. Morgan's boss at ITV, Dame Carolyn McCall. Meghan allegedly implored Dame Carolyn her to censure her critic as they were both women and mothers. And coincidentally, Piers was in the audience at the GQ Awards in London last night where the Duke of Sussex delivered his lecture. Prince Harry told guests, "As people sit in the room with you tonight, more than a third of the global population has received at least one dose of the vaccine. That's more than 5 billion shots given around the world so far. It sounds like a major accomplishment and in many ways it is. But there is a huge disparity between who can and cannot access the vaccine. Less than 2% of people in the developing world have received a single dose at this point. And many of the healthcare workers are still not vaccinated. We cannot move forward together unless we address this imbalance as one. At the same time, families around the world are being overwhelmed by masses of misinformation across news media and social media, where those who peddle in lies and fear are creating vaccine hesitancy, which in turn leads to divided communities and eroding trust. This is a system we need to break if we are to overcome COVID-19 and the risk of new variants." Harry hailed the team behind the Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine, who received the Heroes of the Year Award, as heroes of the highest order, who have done their part. They are our nation's pride and we are deeply indebted to their service. For the rest of us, including global governments, pharmaceutical leaders and heads of business, we have to keep doing our part, he said. That must include sharing vaccine science and supporting and empowering developing countries with more flexibility. Where you are born should not affect your ability to survive when the drugs and know-how exist to keep you alive and well. Within 48 hours of the Oprah interview on March 7 this year, Mr. Morgan was forced to quit GMB after he refused to apologize for his honestly held opinions, costing ITV around 790,000 viewers and millions more in advertising revenue, with the ratings gap between GMB and rival BBC Breakfast still growing. On the day Pierce quit, GMB was in the lead. Other complainants to Ofcom accused Pierce of failing to be duly impartial, misrepresenting facts, and mocking Meghan's American accent. Complaints that his views on GMB on March 8 and March 9 were unsuitable for children were also thrown out. The UK's broadcasting watchdog called attempts to silence the Mail Online columnist a chilling restriction on freedom of expression, after the Duchess of Sussex was among a wave of people who complained that his questioning of her account of royal racism and suicidal thoughts was harmful and offensive to viewers. Ofcom found no rules were breached and backed Mr. Morgan's right to rigorously challenge the Duchess's account of suffering suicidal thoughts and claims she experienced racism at the hands of the royal family. The decision has led to a flurry of calls demanding he is given his job back, with fans using the hashtag #BringBackPiers claiming the show is dying a slow death without him. In complete vindication for the journalist, 56, Ofcom ruled Mr. Morgan was entitled to say he disbelieved the Duke and Duchess of Sussex's allegations and to hold and express strong views that rigorously challenged their account. And in a damning indictment of his former bosses and the 50,000-plus people who complained, the watchdog found, the restriction of such views would, in our view, be an unwarranted and chilling restriction on freedom of expression both of the broadcaster and the audience. The ruling by Ofcom puts CEO Carolyn McCall, formerly of the left-wing Guardian newspaper, under pressure to explain why she did not stick by Mr. Morgan. A decision which has cost the station millions. Mr. Morgan wrote in a Mail Online column yesterday, I'm delighted that Ofcom has so emphatically supported my right to disbelieve the Duke and Duchess of Sussex's incendiary claims to Oprah Winfrey, many of which have since been proved to be untrue. This is a resounding victory for free speech and a resounding defeat for Princess Pinocchio's. In light of this decision, do I get my job back? He added in his column. I was reliably informed recently that Meghan Markle wrote directly to my ITV boss Dame Carolyn McCall the night before I was forced out, demanding my head on a plate. Apparently, she stressed that she was writing to Dame Carolyn personally because they were both women and mothers, a nauseating playing of the gender and maternity card if ever there was one. What has the world come to when a whiny fork-tongued actress can dictate who presents a morning television news program? Is the door ajar for Piers Morgan at GMB? ITV director of TV Kevin Ligo is fighting to rehire the presenter, as viewers sign petitions to get him back on air after his tirade at Meghan Markle's Oprah lies was cleared by Ofcom questions. Remained last night over whether there is still a slim chance that Piers Morgan could return to host Good Morning Britain after he was triumphantly cleared of breaching broadcasting rules by Ofcom. The presenter's former ITV colleagues and a string of respected broadcasters yesterday hailed the regulator's ruling confirming his right to free speech after dismissing more than 57,000 complaints about his criticism of Meghan Markle, including not believing a word she told Oprah Winfrey about her experiences of suicidal thoughts. Last night, The Sun reported that ITV's director of television Kevin Ligo, described as a big fan of Mr. Morgan, was on a one-man mission to bring him back. Although an insider said he was currently fighting a losing battle internally. The development came after the UK's broadcasting watchdog called attempts to silence Mail Online columnist Mr. Morgan a chilling restriction on freedom of expression, after the Duchess of Sussex was among a wave of people who complained that his questioning of her account of royal racism and suicidal thoughts was harmful and offensive to viewers. Following the announcement, however, ITV revealed they have no current plans to invite him to present Good Morning Britain, with one source saying, Piers decided to leave. We accepted his decision. The Sun said that despite my Ligo's lobbying, Good Morning Britain bosses viewed there being a slim to no chance that Mr. Morgan would return to the ITV show, which he quit in the aftermath of the coverage of Meghan and Harry's Oprah interview, which Ofcom went on to investigate. It remains to be seen if other hosting roles at the network could be made available. Speaking about losing his GMB job yesterday after the Ofcom decision, Mr. Morgan said, I didn't want to lose my job in the first place. But I only really want to work for someone who supports freedom of speech and free expression. And I felt frankly that ITV let me down and let their viewers down. Petitions to have Mr. Morgan reinstated in his GMB role are still being signed, with three different appeals on change.org reaching a collective total of 264,201 signatures. Executives at ITV are currently hunting for a potential permanent replacement as the program struggles with viewer figures. It is believed Martin Lewis and Richard Bacon are among the favorites. It comes as Mr. Morgan revealed the number of job offers he has received since leaving ITV's flagship breakfast show has accelerated, since he was found not to have breached Ofcom's broadcasting code. Speaking to The Sun, he slammed the Duchess of Sussex as the Queen of Woke, and described her as a whiny, forked-tongued actress. Mr. Morgan said, the woke brigade think they can vilify, shame, silence and get fired anyone who has an opinion they don't like. Meghan Markle is the queen of this culture, who personally sought to have me lose my job, and succeeded. Why are she and Prince Harry entitled to have their opinion but I'm not entitled to mine? He immediately hit back at ITV's statement for ignoring the central thrust of Ofcom's conclusion, stating that he was entitled to say he disbelieved the Duke and Duchess of Sussex's allegations and to hold and express strong views that rigorously challenge their account. He said yesterday, ITV have just put out a statement saying I only won the Ofcom case against Princess Pinocchio because my colleagues expressed different opinions to mine. That's not what the Ofcom report says in its conclusion. I suggest ITV reads it again. Jan Moyer. Princess Pinocchio has finally had her nose tweaked as at long last a joyful bucket of cold water is thrown on Harry and Meghan's fevered claims by Ofcom verdict exonerating Piers Morgan. Just imagine. Another perfect morning in Montecito, Southern California. As the sun rises over the Santa Ynez Mountains, an ocean breeze ruffles the leaves on the scrub oaks and ripples across the mosaic of swimming pools that stud this millionaire's paradise. Avocado toasts are slipped onto warmed plates. The smell of fresh coffee rises in the land of the elites. And then a terrible, piercing scream rips apart the balmy calm. What awful calamity has occurred? Has the boutique down by the bay run out of sustainable cashmere? Are there too many pips in that organic Meyer lemon? No, it is something much, much worse. Princess Pinocchio has finally had her nose tweaked. For deep inside the Sussex's grand mansion, set in an exclusive gated estate on a private street, a blast of good old blighty reality has crashed in like a meteorite. One can only imagine how the Duchess reacted upon discovering that her complaint against Piers Morgan has been thrown out by Ofcom. But for a woman with such a finely honed sense of victimhood, anything less than volcanic on the Stroppy scale would be a surprise. The Duchess was among the 57,000 people who complained to Ofcom, and personally to ITV when Morgan stated he didn't believe a word of what she told Oprah Winfrey during their interview back in March. I mean, really, Piers was kind enough to give Meghan and Harry the priceless gift of candor, only to have it thrown back in his face without a word of thanks. Yet in moment of triumph for freedom of speech, for UK broadcasters and journalists everywhere, but most of all for the former Good Morning Britain host himself, Ofcom ruled that Mr. Morgan was entitled to say he disbelieved the Duke and Duchess of Sussex's allegations and to hold and express strong views that rigorously challenged their account. So he has been entirely vindicated. While the Duchess has been accused of being part of a chilling restriction on freedom of expression. Oh dear, that is not a good look for a self-styled international humanitarian and do-gooder. A woman who, according to the couple's Archwell website, wants to unleash the power of compassion to drive systemic cultural change. All Megan seems to have driven is her wheezing old jalopy of self-justification into the brick wall of baloney that has awaited her all this time. For sooner or later, this day of reckoning had to come. Since the moment they left to forge a new life in America, the Duke and Duchess of Sussex have been assiduous keepers of their own flame of fame. From day one, they have depicted themselves as victims fleeing from the tyranny of inherited wealth. A couple of rich and privileged pups forever barking about the unfairness of life. My daddy won't give me any money. My daddy talks to the press. It's all so simply awful. From Oprah Winfrey to Instagram statements, from podcasts to Netflix series. From newspaper op-eds to Zoom calls, they have built up their story of suffering and burnished their images without halt. Then of course there is the Finding Freedom biography. The remarkable unofficial histoire written by Carolyn Durand and Omid Scobie that largely seems to reflect their every thought and itch. Along the way, neither of them appear to have minded about any collateral damage caused to the Queen, other members of the royal family, household staff, or even poor Thomas Markle. Then and now, one can only gasp at the ultimate vanity of their quest, to have their truth believed at all times, and to never be questioned. They have tap-tap-tapped the golden syrup from the tree of fib and glib without pause. Their vision, their view, their version of events has spooled out behind them in a wallow of words. Each one carefully curated. Somehow the Sussexes have been able to accuse and counter-accuse, to complain, to control the momentum and the narrative, to indulge their victimhood. Until now. The Ofcom ruling is perhaps their first wake-up call. The point will come when they will have to account for themselves and their accusations, which so far are unsupported by any evidence or detail. Of course, Mr. Scobie is already leading the pushback, citing a clause in the Human Rights Act that says free speech must always be compounded by the protection of health and morals. This, he says, makes me question the Ofcom decision. Well, he is entirely within his rights to do so. Just as Piers Morgan is entirely within his rights to question the Duke and Duchess's statements, many of which, incidentally, have been shown to be untrue. Until now. To criticize the Duchess of Sussex was to be accused of racism, sexism, and worse. One hopes that the Ofcom ruling will at least allow the occasional chip of doubt to be raised. Without the cheapers being cancelled and sent to woke jail by Meghan's permanently furious supporters. This febrile atmosphere, into which these serious accusations of bigotry are thrown around like noxious confetti, is stoked by the Sussexes themselves. All this scurrility propounded by annoyance and huff, spiced with a pinch of what looks increasingly like spite. Surely it doesn't have to be like this? Why do they seem so determined to crush not just the royal family, but anyone of note who disagrees with them along the way? We are all entitled to freedom of speech. It is not a gift granted only to those who hold views acceptable to Harry and Meghan. When I think about the Sussexes, sometimes it seems like a ghost story they have concocted themselves, one that is brooded over by malevolent wraiths, hurts real or imagined, insults perceived. Slights dead and gone. Many will welcome this cold bucket of water that has been poured over the graveyard of their fevered claims. Oh, to have been a fly on the Montecito wall when the news came through. I like to imagine the crash of teacup on saucer and then that prolonged scream, echoing down to where the surf rolls onto the shoreline like a benediction. And if Harry were still juggling at the window, like the circus clown he is at heart, then surely he would have dropped his balls in shock. Source: dailymail.co.uk. Please like, share and subscribe. Thank you for watching.